So hi everyone, thank you for inviting us. Really thrilled to give this talk, and I think there's quite a lot of things that I would love to talk a bit about, and if it's possible, I don't know if it works through the Hangout, maybe even hear some feedback on, because I've been doing a lot of thinking about the strategic implications of APIs, and how it's shaping the world around us, not just the web, but also the world around us, and how it's going to affect or is already affecting Drupal, and what are the threat and the opportunity in it. Because I think there's both a threat, like a really big one actually, and an opportunity both for humanity and for the Drupal project, more specific, well, you know, on both levels actually. But before I start talking about that, I want to talk a little bit about the history of APIs. Because, now, first of all, APIs are a little bit of a... they're a bit of a confusing words, because APIs can be a lot of different things. Back in the days of the mainframes, they also had APIs. APIs is not a new technology. And most of the time when we talk about APIs, we actually mean web APIs. And there's a lot of words that are not very clearly defined, but it turns around that there's like most of the time, especially on the internet, when we talk about APIs and how they're changing our world, for sure, it's about web APIs and not about internal APIs in applications. And the real web APIs, according to Ken Lane, who calls himself, well, you can find him on Developer Evangelist or API Evangelist. He's got a blog, and he has his blog post about the history of APIs. And according to him, web APIs really got started when Salesforce launched in 2000, in the beginning of 2000. Basically, what they did, they were like a CRM, but like APIs first CRM, which was kind of a new thing back in the days. And then very shortly after that, eBay launched their own API program. And then after that, Amazon in 2002 launched their web services. Back then it was not yet this all-encompassing hosting infrastructure stuff, but basically the web services for Amazon's original products. And that was kind of like the start of this whole web API thing. And what web APIs really present are a way to escape, well, not to escape, but they're a way to have more adaptive, complex systems. So what I mean with that is, one of the key things that we've seen Amazon doing in their business is that they've basically decoupled all their business units. Every single business unit was required to create APIs to connect to the other business units. And basically, Amazon is running their business kind of like a decoupled system that that's supposed to interact through APIs with each other. And this was also how they were able to then build the whole hosting infrastructure business, because they were doing this for themselves internally, or like, you know, I remember this is from a while ago when I read this, so if I'm wrong or if I'm not completely factual, let me know. The most important thing is the general picture that I'm shaping. But what they are basically doing is, instead of having this giant organization that needs lots and lots of communication workflows where people need to be involved, they build computer interfaces between their business units. And that was one of the major reasons why they were then able to build the hosting product that they've built. The cloud business was a direct result of that. And that's very interesting. But one of the things, like this is something that I'm doing a lot of research in, because I'm trying to understand where the future is going. If you look at the world, you see that we're going towards more and more complexity. Like systems are becoming more complex. We had that in ecosystems. Like I was talking with my son earlier today about actually why are there no dinosaurs today? And why, you know, how come? And I think for a big part, I think it's partially because by going to smaller units, smaller living creatures, you have much more different, much more options for complexity. Like you can have more complex ecosystems. And if you look at ecosystems, you see that they'll start from a basic level and then they add more complexity. Especially today in a marketplace, if you look at the world's marketplace, you can see this playing out really well, where you see how things are being broken up. You get more and more varieties. Culture shifts. It's always shifting. Everything is always shifting. And it's always shifting towards more complexity. So when you used to have one type of cola, now you have hundreds of types of cola. And cola was already just one type of, how do you call it? Like I'll just say beverage, but I was looking for types of lemonade. So if you look at that, you see that it's kind of like a tree where you start with a trunk and it branches and it branches and it branches and it branches. And you have this, the world really looks like a fractal and is becoming more and more and more complex. And we are driving this now, and this is what is happening in the marketplace. This is why the pace of innovation is accelerating. And if you look around you, you see that we're inventing new things all the time, faster and faster and faster. Like today, it would be hard to imagine a world without smartphones, but that's technology that's like what, 10 years old? Yeah, about, you know, it's maybe a bit more, but like the iPhone, I don't know how much is it now. It's not that long, and we almost can't imagine our lives without anymore. And on top of that platform, a bunch of other things were built. So you see this branching and growing more and more complex. Now, one of the effects of that is that you see an increase in the pace of innovation. And you see that to keep up with the world, you need to increase your rate at which you are innovating. And to be able to do that, you can't just build one big system. You have to build smaller chunks that can have more generations faster and that can evolve faster. And there's it's very, very interesting. But one of the key things that you see in there is that you try to decouple value chains. You try to decouple systems into their smaller components so that those smaller components can evolve faster, so that the whole becomes more adaptive and can change faster with the changing ecosystem. And how that is affecting business, you can look, for example, at the publishing sector. The publishing sector used to be very, well, not simple, but fairly straightforward. You had a newspaper, they had people going into the field, researching articles, writing articles, and publishing articles. And then they had advertisers that were putting, that were giving money to those journals for their audience, most of the time actually for the classified ads. So like, you know, the advertisements, I'm looking for this, I've got this, that kind of stuff. That's what they made a lot of money with. In the internet time, suddenly that was decoupled, because now as a citizen, you no longer needed the newspaper to find the classified ads. You could go to Craigslist or to eBay to buy stuff. Or to buy a car from somebody else, or like all these second-hand platforms that grow up, like finding a place to stay. All of these things basically got decoupled, and newspapers lost a whole chunk of income because their value chain that used to be from end user all the way through, basically new companies sprung up that picked out pieces and deconstructed the value chain of these systems. And you see this happening all over the place, where basically value chains are being deconstructed and decoupled. And APIs play a very important role in this. Because to be able to decouple a value chain, to be able to decouple a system, you need to reduce the cost of communication. And that is exactly what APIs, web APIs, do. They're a generalized open interface to the internet through which unknown parties can interact with other unknown parties. So right now you still have to integrate with a very specific type of API, so you kind of need to build the coupling according to that. But you could imagine a future where you could, for example, say, I run my own personal social network, and I need face recognition. What algorithm has the best price? And you do a and you have an algorithm that's built. What's the name? What's the thing that's written on top of the blockchain? It's escaping me. There's now this. It'll come later. But there's a programming language written on top of blockchain technology that allows you to make contracts that execute themselves without people. So in the very near future, you could imagine a possibility where an API says, hey, I need face recognition. Who's out there who can give me face recognition that works according to these standards? It needs to do this is the quality requirements, this is the maximum price. Who can give that to me? And then three APIs give a bid, and the API picks one of them, executes the contract, sends some money through the blockchain to the other API, and a transaction happens without humans being involved. And basically, APIs facilitate kind of this very smooth and very fast-changing interaction between systems, kind of optimizing this whole process. So this is something that you can start to see happening. Like, we're nowhere near there, but this is probably where things are going. And the reason, why is this accelerating now? And why are APIs becoming so big now? I think that the biggest of that, this actually can be kind of coupled back to the demise of the open web. I don't know if you've read Dries' blog posts about this. Dries has been blogging about this. Matt from WordPress has been blogging about it. There were several other people have been talking about it, that we're moving from everybody doing their own thing to some really large platforms where lots of people come together and do stuff. And the reason why we're doing that is because there's network effects in play. Network effects in play in terms of audience, where if you have a lot of audience, suddenly becomes more interesting to publish there. So more people publish there, so more audience comes, and it grows and grows and grows and grows. And also in terms of data, you get, Facebook has an enormous amount of pictures about people. And Facebook has this feature where you can say, that's my uncle, my uncle Daniel, this is my niece, blah, blah, and whatever. And you're basically helping them train their algorithm for face recognition. And all of this collected data is enabling a artificial intelligence. And not like artificial intelligence as in the robots going to come to get you, but as artificial intelligence, as specialized artificial intelligence on a very, very narrow field, like face recognition or pattern recognition or there's a few of these things. Well, there's actually quite a lot of them. Where if we can train robots, they can actually become better than humans. We've seen it now with Go. As long as there's enough data, computers can get really, really good in a very narrow field. And so if you get a lot of data about a very specific type of thing, and you start applying computer processing to it and better recognition, we can build specialized artificial intelligence that's able to make things, that's basically able to do magic. Because suddenly a computer can, there's this story about this lady, this couple that started getting advertisements about diapers. And we're like, we're not parents. Why are they sending us ads about diapers? And then a few weeks later, if they found out that the wife was pregnant. And I don't know if this is a true story. It sounds very creepy. But I think it actually might be true, because computers are watching now a lot of what we're doing, and the grocery store where you're buying, if you're going always to the same grocery store, they know a lot about you and your habits. And when you change your habits, they might make certain conclusions. And this is where But to be able to do artificial intelligence and specialized artificial intelligence, you need a lot of data. So you need to collect a lot of data, and that's why there's this aggregation of information. And now, one thing, like I talked about a little while, so I've gone through this whole thing. I'll go a little bit back. AI is also, it's an opportunity, it's also a threat, because like, where is the place of humans in this whole, in the world, basically? And like right now, we're kind of the king of our world, and we're, you know, we control the world, and we have, and we take that for granted. But like the world was not built to serve us. Well, except maybe for some people might believe that it's true, but I don't believe that the world was built to serve our purposes. I don't think that in the future necessarily all of society will be in the light of humans. And this is kind of troubling, and there's a lot of smarter people thinking about this and trying to figure out how can we make sure that we don't get any doomsday scenarios? How can we make sure that humans stay relevant? And that's a very, very important question. But before we get there, before AIs are going to eat humanity, or potentially eat, I think personally that the super intelligence has already evolved. Like I agree with Kevin Kelly on that. If you look at the world, not as like, you know, on a human scale, but if you look at a global scale, you see that the internet basically connects everything. And the internet is like a massive neural network that connects all humans or a lot of humanity into one single organism. I think that the superorganism that we're fearing or that we're thinking about probably already exists. And that it's basically humanity with all of technology interwoven. And that basically all of Earth is becoming one hyperintelligence on a whole different level than our intelligence. And we can't really see it. Probably we can't even communicate with it because it's just on a whole different scale. It's a little bit like an ant nest. A single ant, you know, is just an ant. It's kind of stupid. Whole ant nest becomes a colony, and they do all kinds of interesting things. Like if you look at ants, they're basically kind of on a cellular level, and we might interact with an ant nest as individuals on our kind of level of complexity. The same way you could look at all of the world as like a higher level of complexity around it. And now, but that's kind of like, you know, the fear for humanity. I think there's another thing where we need to look at and that we need to be careful with. It's like, how do we stay relevant as a Drupal community? Because one thing that I see happening a lot is this decoupling of systems where people start, like I've heard a lot of people talking about static sites with microservices incorporated and how that allows you, like if you have a lot of money and you have developers that are not going to be hired away, and then at this point, probably if you're building a business, you're better off, like if it's like if your product is a software piece, you're probably better off building it as microservices, because you can iterate on them much faster on these individual levels than you can on like the whole level. Now, but where does that leave things like Drupal, like CMSs like Drupal, that are fairly complex systems that are interweaving a bunch of things? And I've asked this question also at DrupalCon, and we had a really interesting discussion. There was one example that was that I thought was really beautiful, was that in France there's a project now where they're using Drupal as the kind of the template system. So that it's the content store, and it collects all the microservices together, and then it spits out the HTML for the consumer. So basically, Drupal has become a sort of orchestrator and content store, and you could and that Drupal is a little bit older, like now 10 years, or well, it's more than 10 years, but that Drupal is a little bit older, 13 years, I think, is actually an advantage because it gives trust. It's kind of like databases. Like you also want something that's a little bit more robust and that's been around for a while and that's looks like it's going to be around for another while. You don't want to put your data, like especially your content and the stuff you write, into something ephemeral that might disappear. So probably there's a space there for Drupal where we could be like, even in really large systems, even in systems where there's a lot of dedicated developers that can work on it, that we can play a role. There's other roles, like as an innovation platform and a place where we can standardize on. It also plays a really important role, I think, because it makes it easier for people to collaborate. But it's very important, I think, to think about this. We've started working with our company. We're working on with Promvix. We're working on an alliance with API companies, so companies, commercial companies that have APIs, and to help them integrate with Drupal and to like do that on a sustainable way, so that they're giving back to the community. It's something that we'll be launching hopefully by the Dev Days in Milan. It's not 100% sure yet, but that's something we're working on. So, but I think everybody needs to be thinking about APIs today, because they are going to impact your life massively. They're all going to impact our businesses. Like Drupal will be impacted massively by APIs. And either we can become kind of like a GUI, because Drupal is basically a graphical user interface for APIs. Like currently, it's mostly internal APIs. It's the Drupal APIs. But you could imagine Drupal as a GUI for web APIs, where it has some internal APIs, it has some web APIs, and you can do things like with the rules module that you can string all these APIs together to do really interesting, complex things. So this is something that we might be looking at. We need to look at how do we integrate with APIs. We need to look at how do we produce APIs and how do we do that on a way that's going to be competitive with other ways of doing things. So if we don't do that, we'll be left behind. Also, WordPress is looking at becoming an API system. We're probably ahead of the game. I was at WordCamp last weekend, and there they were talking about trying to get REST API, like a REST module, into core in WordPress core, but that's not a done deal yet. So there's a lot of there's a really strong movement in that direction, and so I'm thrilled to talk about that and to share ideas. And if you have any ideas about this and about this whole complexness and how to react on it and how to interact with it, so that we can thrive and that we can keep thriving as a community, please do contact me, because I'm really interested in that. And on that note, I think that's my last slide. Yeah, that's my last slide. I'd like to hand over the word, unless there's now maybe questions.
As I said in this presentation, I would like to highlight some necessary features and challenges of mature and successful APIs. The fundamentals of this presentation aren't strictly related to Drupal. These are common challenges of different implementations. It could be Node.js, Go, and so on. But since we are at a Drupal user group meeting, I will talk about a little bit about how much Drupal-based APIs can fulfill these requirements. So these are the common challenges or requirements of successful APIs. I think in the end of my presentation, I will try to recommend you an extension. Let's call it that way for now. This extension is one from the many which you can use in the top of your backend services to help them fulfill all of these requirements. First is security, which important should be quite clear to anyone. APIs usually exposes private and valuable data, so it is critical question how can you handle access management and prevent unauthorized access. Next is compatibility, which basically about how can you handle changes in your service implementation. Does your service work with different platforms and devices? Adding resources, methods, and attributes is usually not a big problem, but what will happen if you change the semantics of your existing methods or remove resources, methods, or attributes? These are really serious questions, just as scalability. So when your APIs became publicly available, or just your client's number is increasing dramatically, will your backend service be ready to handle the storm? I hope you can see that you cannot ensure the first three requirements without proper monitoring and analytics system. Monitoring helps you to detect bad bots and access management issues, to identify the root of performance problems and determine the perfect time to scale. So the main challenge here is, can you analyze your APIs and backend services to see problems before it would happen? But the most important part for the developers is the API documentation, because even a perfectly implemented API is worthless without a good documentation and solid developer community. And there is a plus one here, which called monetization. This is also important these days, because most digital companies which exposes their valuable data with APIs are doing this for revenue. So from the business perspective, it is inevitable to be able to define different API products over your API resources with different properties like daily or concurrent access limitations. These API products with different service plans can be presented as bundles to developers. Monetization also requires periodical billing documentation generation to your clients. You cannot even think monetization of your APIs if your current backend system cannot capable to fulfill the first 5 points of this list correctly. So what does it mean for us as Drupal developers or customers who large Drupal sites holds valuable information that could be useful outside of their site context? Let's see what we can achieve out of the box with Drupal 7 and Drupal 8 from these points in a few words. So Drupal 7 is still a great content management framework, and Drupal 8 is even better than the 7 because of plenty of reasons. When the Drupal 7 was built, the web was limited to pages, and therefore it was created to be a general page building tool. As a side effect of this, everything is a page in Drupal 7, basically. Although this didn't stop the community to build modules like services, RESTful, and REST-VS to help external application to use Drupal 7 sites as a backend service. So return response is in JSON, XML, or any other structured format. These modules prove to be a really powerful tools to expose data from your Drupal 7 sites. But when your API gained too much popularity, then you might notice performance problems, which caused by the Drupal 7 so loved full bootstrap process. To avoid this problem, you can use more exotic solutions like the GS or the endpoint modules, but they have drawbacks, because you will not get any support to anything. You have to implement your own resources, and you must ensure the security as well. So let's get back to the first modules and the different extensions. In general, implementing security is not a big issue with these modules. The most commonly used authentication method is OAuth 2.0 with OAuth module, I think. You also get some support to compatibility management if you choose to use them. But if you use them or any other REST implementation which relies to the Drupal 7's built-in hook menu system, you might have performance problem, as I said. Also, you cannot monitor your resources performance directly, just the server's performance under the site. Of course, you can build custom analytics inside your and resources, but this type of data collection also could have affect the performance. Finally, defining API products is definitely requires custom implementation, which might not be as perfect as it should be. But what about Drupal 8? I think Miro will tell you more about Drupal 8 REST APIs, and maybe he will fix what I will say about it. So we all know Drupal 8 brought us a lot of changes. For example, everything is an HTTP response in Drupal 7, which could be anything, sometimes a page. This is a really big improvement since the 7, as you can see. So Drupal 8 solution should be should have better performance than with Drupal 7. Moreover, the Drupal 8 core itself contains the basic modules for building REST APIs with Drupal. Also, there is an initiative for self-documented REST APIs, which will be also a great addition to Drupal 8 itself. Also, services module is still with us, and it tries to be a great extension to the core features. Unfortunately, as I see, the monitoring and monetization capabilities of the system hasn't changed, and it hasn't improved. So these are still problems. Solutions. So how can we fix these problems? As I said in the beginning, my presentation is about general changes, general challenges of successful APIs, and it isn't about gathering problematic parts of Drupal-based APIs. We are 90% a Drupal company, and we choose Drupal because it makes our life much more easier. It's a powerful tool even for larger sites. So I would like to emphasize that building mature APIs is not easier with other technology stacks. First of all, each of them has its own limitation, and most of them cannot provide you the Drupal 7 or 8 built-in features either out of the box. And fortunately, we have recently found a solution which could be helpful to anyone who works with APIs. So this is not just for service providers, but also for application developers. This solution is one from the many, and we haven't investigated other possibilities, because the developer portals built with Drupal, and we are working on those. This is the only one we know, and we see a really big potential in it. This solution is called Apigee Edge. Apigee Edge is a software which built in Java, and you can use it as an API proxy. So rather than having application developers consume your services directly, they can access to it through the API proxy, which created by the Edge. Because application developers makes HTTP requests to the API proxy rather than directly to your backend service, developers do not know anything about your implementation of your services. This means that you can maintain the consistent front-end API, and you can change the backend service implementation without causing any issues and for the existing clients. But Edge can do more than this for you, because it can fulfill every requirement as requirements of mature APIs. So there is this phrase policies, which is an Edge-related thing. First of all, we have to define another phrase called flow, which essentially means that the data flow between clients, the API proxy, and your backend service. So you can add policies each step of this data flow. For example, you can execute policies on your backend service replies before it would have been forwarded to client application. There are four group of these policies: traffic management, mediation, security, and extension. I will tell you more about them on the next slide, and I will explain which features belongs to each of them. Let's get back to our six points, which describe a mature API, and see how Apigee Edge can help you with these points. Security. So Apigee Edge, your first protection layer is the API proxy itself, which, as I said, hides your real backend service from the public. You can even let the Edge to handle the authentication and authorization to your service completely. You can use O 2.0 here as well. You can add various policies to your proxies and set up rate limitation, flood control, and to protect your original resources from hackers or malfunctioning clients. The Edge is able to handle compatibility as well. So you can handle other types of compatibility issues with it. For example, if a client application isn't able to parse or send JSON response to XML because some reasons, in this case you can use a JSON to XML or XML to JSON policies from the extension group to convert incoming and outgoing responses to appreciated formats. You can also use versioning on your API proxies as well. Performance issues could be handled most of the time with properly set up caching. You will not be surprised when I will tell you that there are policies to do that. So basically, you can use the Apigee Edge as a response proxy to offload recurring requests from your backend services. And monitoring, I think this is the best feature of the Edge, because each proxy is collecting information asynchronously when data processed through them. Because of this implementation, it has no side effect to your API performance. The collected information includes URLs, IPs, user IDs, latencies, headers, error data, and so on. From the collected performance data, you can see a short or a long-term usage trends of your APIs, as you can see in the screenshot in the sheet. You can generate custom business or analytics reports and identify problematic parts of your backend services easily. The Apigee Edge analytics service also continuously analyzing metrics like number of messages received, number of developers, response times, and it generates instant reports for you. Sorry? So, documentation. Edge users also has an option to have a developer portal, which I have mentioned earlier, to build communities around their APIs. These are Drupal-based developer portals, and they have a built-in capability to import and display open API, previously called Swagger, or SmartDocs API documentation. These APIs, these developer portals could be hosted on-site or off-site, and if you choose the on-site hosting, then Apigee will handle the developer portal site updates as well. And the last one, the most problematic part, as you all know, it requires a solid implementation for all of the previously mentioned requirements because it relies on them. The Edge itself contains a built-in monetization system, which lets you to specify API products from a group of your API proxies and sell them with different plans like a prepaid, postpaid, variable rate plan, and so on. Edge is also able to generate billing documents and to your clients automatically and periodically. In my opinion, this is amazing because you can offload plenty of requirements from your backend service and build successful APIs with it. Of course, this doesn't mean that you do not need to implement a solid authentication system. You should use auto-authentication between your backend service and the Edge. But these additional features that the Edge or any other Edge-like service can provide you could be a really big help if you are a digital company owner to build a better API for services faster, and if you are a client app developer you will be able to work with better APIs with better documentations. And as a backend service developer, you will sleep well because your system is secured and protected and monitorized. that was my presentation. Do you have any questions about it?
Thank you for your presentation. Do you have any questions, guys?
I have one small remark still. Like, for full disclosure, we are working with Apigee, so they are a customer of ours. So I want to make that clear, so that you know we don't just purely promote them. There's other tools similar to Apigee, but because they're working with Drupal, they're probably closer to our community, and that's why we're working with them.
Yeah,
thank you. Yeah. Any questions? Miro Michalička a som momentálne Drupal developer v spoločnosti Chappers. O čom budem hovoriť v mojej prezentácii? Dobre, takže začnem najprv o best practices návrhu API. To už mierne bolo naznačené. Následne sa presuniem k tomu, čo vlastne decoupling je a aké možnosti pre decoupling sú v Drupal 7 a Drupal 8, a nakoniec vám ukážem krátke demo týchto možností. Tak poďme hneď od začiatku. Väčšinu z týchto best practices už naozaj spomínal Dežo. Ja som čerpal zo stránky toptal.com, kde napísali, myslím si, že veľmi dobrý článok na túto tému. Poďme teda od začiatku. Podľa mňa veľmi dôležitá je dokumentácia, alebo keď vaše apička nebude zdokumentované, tak proste ľudia nebudú vedieť, ako ho používať, a tým pádom ho jednoducho nebudú používať. V dnešnej dobe už existuje veľa toolov, kde si proste nahážete, že ten môj endpoint má vrácať takéto údaje, a ten endpoint vám priamo vygeneruje triedy v tom danom jazyku, vygeneruje vám kompletnú dokumentáciu. Príklad takéhoto toolu je napríklad APR-y. Druhým dôležitým bodom je stabilita a konzistentnosť. Keď ste niekedy robili s Facebookovým apičkom, tak asi viete, že ako veľmi je stabilné, že proste neprejde pomaly ani mesiac bez toho, aby tam nespravili nejakú zmenu. To na developerov aplikácií, teda pravdepodobne na vás, znamená to, že neustále musíte tú svoju aplikáciu updatovať. Čiže sú to nejaké kontinuálne náklady pre vás. Pod konzistenciou sa v tomto prípade rozumie to, že keď máte nejaké filtrovanie, tak by ste ho mali mať konzistentné. Či ho dávate cez parameter, alebo ako časť URL-ky napríklad. Tretím parametrom je flexibilita. To, ako Dežo spomínal, je, že nebudem to poskytovať iba ako JSON, pretože backendové systémy môžu chcieť komunikovať radšej cez SOAP, cez XML-ka. Security, toto je asi jediná časť, ktorú Drupal zvláda skoro bezchybne. Ako bolo už prezentované, tak existuje priamo v jadre Basic Out, potom sú rôzne pluginy, či už cez cookie autentifikácia, OAuth, integrácia nejakých externých authentication providerov, Google, Twitter, cez tieto sociálne siete, ďalšie nejaké. Posledný bod tu mám, že jednoduchosť adaptovania sa na to apičko, to je vlastne súhrn všetkých predchádzajúcich tých bodov, lebo každý bude vplývať na to, že ako jednoducho sa bude s tým apičkom začínať pracovať. Čo je to teda ten decoupling? V angličtine sa používa termín headless Drupal pre decoupling, čo môže znamená napríklad aj toto pre niekoho. V podstate to ale znamená, že tá vaša Drupalová apka bude poskytovať dáta pre nejaké ďalšie aplikácie, či to už budú nejaké ďalšie sajty, alebo to môžu byť mobilné aplikácie, nejaká kiosková aplikácia do nejakých iných systémov. A tieto systémy samozrejme môžu komunikovať aj navzájom, čiže nemusia sa spracovávať v tých systémoch iba dáta z tej vašej apky. A takisto tá vaša apka nemusí dostávať iba dáta z toho jedného systému. Decoupling v Drupale má nejaké výhody, má nejaké nevýhody. Tými výhodami je flexibilita frontendu, čiže jednoducho použijete si najnovší JavaScriptový framework, najnovšie CSS štandardy. V Drupal 7 to boli ešte problémy, napríklad jQuery tam nebolo v aktuálnej verzii, museli sa ďalšie moduly. Nebolo všetko v jadre pripravené pre toto najnovšie jQuery. V Drupal 8 už to až taký problém nie je, ale ešte stále váš frontend ak môže chcieť pracovať s nejakými novšími, viac up-to-date technológiami. Druhou výhodou je, že vyriešite nedostatok Drupalových špecialistov, čiže jednoducho potrebujete Drupalistu iba, aby on vyvinul backend, ten frontend už dokáže vyvinúť hociaký, no nie hociaký, ale dokáže to v podstate general frontend developer, nemusí mať žiadnu znalosť Drupalu. Ako ste videli na tom predchádzajúcom obrázku, tak ďalšou výhodou je, že môžete používať viacero aplikácií ako backend pre tú vašu aplikáciu. Čiže budem ťahať z nejakého CRM-ka dáta, potom zo svojho redakčného systému, z nejakého účtovného systému, trebárs v prípade e-shopov. A stále, pokiaľ si správne navrhnete tú decoupled aplikáciu, tak budete môcť využívať výhody, ktoré vám ponúka backend Drupalu, alebo teda aj jeho backoffice, čiže tá administračná zóna. Poďme k tým nevýhodám. Keďže si budete robiť celý ten frontend sami, tak môžete stratiť niektoré veci, ktoré vám Drupal ponúka. Týka sa to hlavne nejaké optimalizácie pre čítačky pre slepých, nejaké vylepšenia v rámci prístupnosti, ktoré už majú tie Drupal témy štandardne zabudované. Ďalšou nevýhodou je, že pokiaľ budete teda robiť celú aplikáciu, budete chcieť ťahať nie iba dáta, ktoré sa zobrazujú na tej stránke, ale napríklad štruktúru menu, nejaké ďalšie bloky, tak musíte jednoducho spraviť viacej requestov na ten Drupal, čo už ale zase s HTTP 2 protokolom nemusí byť až taký problém, keďže tie requesty sa budú baliť k sebe. A poslednou nevýhodou, ktorú aspoň ja vnímam, je, že sa vám zväčší tým, pretože potrebujete v podstate časť týmu, ktorá bude rozumieť Drupalu, ďalšia časť týmu, ktorá bude vedieť spraviť ten frontend. Ešte keď nebude robíte niečo zložitejšie, tak budete nejaký integračný tým potrebovať a ten dvoj-trojčlovekový Drupal tým vám zrazu narastie na 5-6 ľudí. Tie nevýhody sa dajú vyriešiť tým, že nebudete robiť plne decoupled aplikáciu. Teraz hovorím o mechanizme Big Pipe, čo je v podstate kešovací mechanizmus, postavený na tom, že statické objekty sa natiahnú do tej stránky ako prvé, pretože sú nakešované, a tie dynamické sa doťahujú cez nejaké restové apičko. Čiže time to interaction je oveľa nižší ako v prípade klasickej stránky. Vidíte to porovnanie 3 až 4 sekundy v prípade normálnej stránky a po sekunde už môžete interagovať s tou čiastočne decoupled stránkou. Aké sú teda možnosti decouplingu v Drupal 7? Asi každý pozná modul services, tie ďalšie dva RESTful web services a modul RESTful sú nie až také známe. porovnával som v tejto časti prednášky vlastne s tými best practices, či sú nejako dodržané, či sa to dá implementovať. Tento RESTful Web Services je vlastne základ pre Drupal 8-čkový modul, čo znamená, že už vo verzii pre Drupal 7 bol čiastočne objektovo orientovane napísaný. Nedalo sa tam robiť ale verzie jednotlivých endpointov. Tento services modul bol asi také najčastejšie riešenie, keď ste riešili nejakú decoupled aplikáciu, potrebovali ste posúvať data von z tej vašej aplikácie. Výhodou je, že ako jediný z týchto troch modulov, ktoré boli pre Drupal 7, má aktívny development pre Drupal 8 a takisto ponúka už aj verziovanie apička. Jeho nevýhodou je teda procedurálny kód, ale tak keď sa na to pozrieme z kontextu Drupal 7, tak Drupal 7 bol celý napísaný procedurálnym štýlom, takže to nemusí byť až taký problém. Posledný modul, ktorý som našiel a považujem ho pravdepodobne za najlepší, je modul RESTful. Jednak je plne OOP a verziovanie API sa tam robí oveľa, oveľa jednoduchšie a intuitívnejšie ako pre tých predchádzajúcich modulov. Čo sa týka nevýhod, tak v praxi som ten modul moc nepoužíval, ale zatiaľ, čo som ho používal, tak som nenašiel žiadne nevýhody. Poďme teraz k tomu Drupal 8. Ako už bolo spomínané, tak v Drupal 8 máme konečne REST v jadre. Čo je teda veľkou výhodou, ale nevýhoda je, že stále nemáme natívnu podporu verziovania apička a je tu približne 60 tiketov v backlogu. Niektoré z nich sú podľa mňa dosť základné, ale našťastie je to iba, že proste site builder to všetko nenakliká jednoducho, ale musíte niečo programovať k tomu. Tento Drupal 8 REST tvoria v podstate niekoľko modulov. Môžeme si povedať, že teda jeden je ten hlavný, ten REST modul, ktorý poskytuje tie dáta. A potom ešte, aby ste si vedeli budovať nejaké výstupy pre zoznamy, tak je už aj REST výstup z Viewsov. Poďme si prejsť teraz niektoré problémy, na ktoré môžete naraziť. Prvým z takýchto problémov môže byť autentikácia. V jadre priamo sú autentikácia pomocou cookies a potom basic out, to je to, že dáte B64 encodnutý login a password do requestu. A potom je tu možnosť napísať si vlastný autentikačný provider, čo je podľa mňa oproti Drupal 7 dosť jednoduchšie. V podstate na vývoj pre Drupal 8 asi budete využívať, ak budete teda programovať pre Drupal 8, tak budete využívať Drupal konzolu, ktorá vám ponúka také pekné generovatko. V podstate vypluje vám triedu, interfejs k nej a vy si už píšete iba vašu vlastnú business logiku. Pre tento prípad vlastného autentikačného providera to vyzerá nejako takto. Ja som sa vlastne snažil vytvoriť autentikačný provider pomocou nejakého telefónneho čísla a pinu, ako má napríklad Alva na svojich pobočkách. Čiže toto všetko vám vygeneruje tá Drupal konzola. A toto je vlastne potom dve funkcie, ktoré si musíte implementovať sami. Tá prvá funkcia applies, tak pomocou tej funkcie určite, že či sa vôbec má ten autentikačný provider brať do úvahy. Čiže keď nenájdem v hlavičke PIN a telefónne číslo, tak vrátim false, inak vrátim true, čiže sa použije. Keď teda sa už vieme, že sa ide použiť tento autentikačný provider, tak samotná tá business logika sa robí pomocou metódy Authenticate. A tam si už napíšete svoju business logiku. V tomto prípade to bolo, že som si vyťahol z hlavičiek PIN a telefónne číslo a potom som vyťahoval usera, ktorý mal to telefónne číslo a PIN priradené v nejakých svojich poliach. V tomto prípade mohli by sme si to cez nejakú ďalšiu entitu alebo alternatú user entitu. A potom v podstate výsledok toho query, keď nie je prázdny, tak vrátite objekt toho usera, inak vyhodíte nejakú access denied HTTP exception, ktorá sa vo výsledku vráti 404. Ďalších problémov je samotné to APIčko, ako som hovoril, teda samotný ten REST. Ako som hovoril, tak tie APIčka nie sú natívne verziovateľné, čiže keď si ich chcete nejako rozumne verziovať, tak si musíte tie endpointy sami napísať. Znovu si ich ale dokážete pomerne jednoducho vygenerovať, dostane sa k tomu postupne. Druhá možnosť, keď chcete robiť nejaké zoznamy, tak z Views dokážete dostať nejaký výstup, viete si zvoliť, v akom formáte momentálne sú podporované JSON, HALJSON, čo je nejaký obohatený JSON o linkové dáta, a potom je tam ešte, myslím, XML-ko. Na takýto problém môžete naraziť pri tom endpointe cez Views, že keď si chcete vybrať access, teda že ako bude limitovaný prístup k tej URL-ke, tak jednoducho narazíte na to, že viete vybrať iba nejaké permissiony alebo rolu, neviete vybrať metódu autentikácie. To sa dá vyriešiť pomocou root subscriberu, ktorý sa dá, myslím, že tiež vygenerovať cez tú Drupal konzolu. A v podstate, čo robím v tom root subscriber je, že sa pozriem, že či to je ten môj view, a keď to je ten môj view, tak mu poviem, že autentifikuj sa pomocou basic autu a ešte kontroluj to vždy, keď ideš na tú URL-ku. Potom vlastne priradím tú upravenú rútu do nejakej tej kolekcie. Keď by to fungovalo korektne, tak by to malo vyzerať nejako takto. Jednoducho vyberiete si spôsob autentifikácie v UIčku, vyberiete si, pre ktorú rolu sa to má, nemá aplikovať, čiže oveľa jednoduchšie znovu pre toho site buildera. Keď ste programátor, tak nemáte problém ani s tým root subscriberom moc. Tento ticket konkrétny je rozpracovaný na Drupal.org, čiže ak máte náhodou nejaké voľné kapacity alebo chcete trošku prispieť, tak tam to nájdete a môžete. Sú tam už nejaké peče, neviem, či to dokonca už nebolo aj niekedy teraz nedávno slohnuto. Ako som spomínal, tak tie vlastné endpointy si viete znovu vygenerovať pomocou Drupal konzoly. Toto... Okay. Ten prvý boxík je príkaz, pomocou ktorého si to vygenerujete, a vlastne to pod tým je trieda, ktorú vám to vygeneruje. Keď si všimnete, tak ono je to pomocou, ono je ten endpoint definovaný pomocou nejakej anotácie pred tou triedou. V tomto prípade je ten zavináč REST resources a vidíte tam časť URI path, čo znamená, že aké všetky HTTP metódy sú podporované v tejto, ale nie podporované, ale implementované v tejto triede. Čiže keď tam mám iba tú canonical, tak to je, že tam je iba obyčajný get, myslím, že to by malo byť ešte používané iba pre head dokonca. Tieto URI cesty sa dajú nájsť, sú to nejaké zadefinovaný string pre ten kľúč a potom už za rovná sa si dávate tú cestu, ktorú chcete používať. Keď už si vyrobíte tie svoje endpointy, tak ich treba nejako povoliť, že aké metódy chcete povoliť, aké formáty chcete podporovať, akých autentifikačných providerov chcete pre ten endpoint poskytovať. To môžete buď spraviť priamo cez editáciu YAML súboru, teda konfiguračného súboru v Drupal 8, to je ten kód na pravej strane, alebo môžete využiť modul, ktorý sa volá REST-UI a ten vám vlastne spraví UIčko na editáciu toho YAML súboru. Poďme teraz k nejakému demu krátkemu. Čiže mám nainštalovaný Drupal 8, 8.0.6, 8 minútku som ešte pre istotu pre to demo neriskoval, aj keď má vyjsť za 6 dní. Pozrime si tie moduly, ktoré nám prídu priamo s jadrom. Oni sú v tabe Web Services a vlastne vidíte, že mám tu už aj ten REST-UI modul, ktorý je ináč kontribuovaný, čiže si ho musíte stiahnuť. Ale v podstate máte tu ten RESTful Web Services, to je úplne ten základný. A potom tu máte serializáciu, to je zase iba nejaká závislosť a potom tu máte ešte zvlášť ten HAL, lebo to teda nejako ľudia často nepoužívajú, keďže je ten formát zložitejší trošku. A nakoniec teda tá basic autentikácia. No, povolím si ešte tú basic autentikáciu. OK, máme ho povolený. A poďme sa pozrieť na tie endpointy, ktoré nám prichádzajú priamo z jadra, teda bez toho, aby sme čokoľvek robili. Idem do toho modulu REST-UI a tu vidíte zoznam vlastne všetkých endpointov. Keď ste používali services pre Drupal 7, tak viete, že to tam bolo pre nejaké základné entity ako pre content, taxonomy term usera. A potom napríklad bol rozšírenie pre commerce. Tuto momentálne, keďže všetko sú v podstate entity, tak pre všetky entity vám existuje endpoint. Hneď ten prvý vidíte pre content. Tá cesta, ako som hovoril, nie je veľmi pekná. Node, lomitko, idečko, nodu, no, že chcem k tomu pristupovať už nejako štrukturovane, že na základe content type treba alebo nejaké ďalšie filtre. Zeditujme si tento. Čiže klikám na edit a vidíte, že môžete si povoliť jednotlivé HTTP metódy, čiže get, post, delete a patch. A ešte pre každú túto metódu si zvlášť môžete povoliť, aké formáty majú byť podporované a takisto aké autentifikačné providery majú byť podporovaní. Pre post, myslím, ak sa to ešte stále nezmenilo, tak pre post je podporovaný iba HAL.json formát. Čiže keď by som si dal get a chcem podporovať JSON, basic autentikácia, save a ešte musím vybrať niečo pre tie ostatné. A teraz keď si spustím terminál prebárs, tak môžem robiť normálny curl, kde URL-ka bude teda http drupalusergroup.dd na porte 8083 metódu nemusím špecifikovať, pretože pretože je to get a je defaultná a potom potrebujem akurát tak poslať hlavičku. Ja ešte vlastne potrebujem, že to chcem requestovať, čiže napríklad node 1, dajme tomu. A potom potrebujem poslať hlavičku s tou svojou basic autentifikáciou. Myslím, že to je minus H authentication basic a ešte to potrebujem prehodiť do B64, čiže nejaký base 64 online. Má super bezpečné heslo. Ono je to vlastne spojené login, dvojbodka, heslo. A ja chcem enkodovať. Dobre, čiže admin heslo. Takto. A teraz mi to vyhodilo nejaký error, ktorý pravdepodobne hovorí o tom, že nemám takú page.
Áno, preto to sa nám nepáčia core servisy.
Napríklad.
HTTP. Alebo hej, postane tiež.
Som to mal duk.dd 8083 node 1 authorization basic admin heslo. Ono je to tá hlavička authorization. Teraz keď to pošlem, tak znovu to dostanem, pretože ako hovorím, tak určite mám vytvorený ten patient found. Dobre, môžem si povoliť ten...
Dá sa niekde povedať tým core-ovým servisom, aby posielali normálny response, nejaký taký programaticky parsovateľný?
Nie, ale on ti to pošle odpoveď,
keď
si pozrieš hlavičky, tak ono to pošle.
Čo to poslalo? Not found by malo poslať.
No, 404 by to malo poslať.
No, a čo nám to hovorí?
Počkaj, nezabudem to náhodou niečo, na niečo.
Ale to vyzerá, ako keby si ani nerequestol.
Jasné.
Ja skôr musím requestnúť správne formáty.
A stále mi to vráti.
Message. Path node was. The node parameter.
Dobre, skúsme to s tým userom. Takže jutro nám vrátilo, pekne vidíte všetky parametre. Áno, zabudol som na to, že vlastne nepoužíva handling formát, Drupalo sa nepoužíva handling formátu cez hlavičku, čiže nenastavíte si hlavičke, že aký očakávate návratový formát, ale to nastavujete v tej URL-ke cez podtržitko formát. Sa rovná JSON. Ono je to z toho dôvodu tak, že používa sa, že Drupal 8 používa Symfony, zo Symfony používa nejaký HTTP Foundation komponent a tento komponent handluje formáty takýmto štýlom. Dobre, to sme si ukázali získanie nejakého jednoduchého resursu. Poďme sa pozrieť na tie views. Idem do štruktúra views a pokiaľ mám všetko správne povolené, tak pri pridávaní nového view by som mal vidím túto REST export settings, čiže v podstate zaškrtnem, dajme si list of users, chcem vracať používateľov, nezotriedených a chcem ich mať dostupných na URL-ke users, all users. All users. Tu vidíte rovno aj preview, ako pri normálnych štandardných viewsoch. Teraz momentálne sa zobrazuje celá tá entita vyrenderovaná. Môžeme si to zmeniť iba na jednotlivé fieldy, čiže napríklad potrebujem iba UID od toho usera. Nie UUID, entity ID. User ID. A viete na to normálne štandardné formátory používať. Teraz, keďže som tam nechal zaškrtnuté, že linkuj mi to na to je pri tom predchádzajúcom to meno, keďže má zaškrtnuté, že linkuj na usera, tak je tam v podstate celá URL-ka. Keď to teraz odškrtnem, tak by som tam mal mať iba admin, UID, zároveň si viem cez tieto settingy upravovať, že ako sa má volať tento pole, čiže nechcem, aby sa volalo name, ale chcem, aby sa volalo username a nechcem UID, ale iba ID. Keď by som sa chcel zbaviť tomu kódu, ktorý mi tam dalo, tak pozaškrtávam. Dáva mi surový výstup a teraz to už dáva štandardne v pohode. Normálne aplikuje sa na to pager, aj kontextuálne filtre, keby si dáte do URL nejaký parameter, tak berie to normálne ako štandardné viewsy, s tým viete pracovať. Čiže nič také špeciálne pri týchto viewsoch, keď tuto mi to vráti, to tu asi má niečo nakašované tento postman. Dobre, to by bolo pravdepodobne z nema všetko, nejdem teraz ukazovať to generovanie kódu, to je fakt dosť primitívne a potom už tam ide skoro business logiku, ktorá nemá moc s tým REST spoločné. Takže ja vám ďakujem za pozornosť a máte niekto nejaké otázky?
Už to máš na nejakom projekte živom?
Mám to na nejakých testovacích projektoch. Uh-huh. Na živom momentálne na žiadnom. 28. 29. mája bude Československý Drupal v Bratislave. Bude to na fakulte matematiky, fyziky a informatiky v Mlynskej doline. Ten prvý deň bude vlastne konferenčný, čiže pripravujeme dva tracky. Jeden track by mal byť čisto čeština, slovenčina, druhý track budeme sa snažiť dotiahnuť prednášajúcich, ktorí budú prednášať v angličtine. A toho 29. pripravujeme nejaké tréningy. Už teraz môžem povedať, že máme potvrdených lektorov na Symfony pre Drupalistov, čiže to bude jeden tréning, potom druhý tréning budeme asi my ako Drupal asociácia robiť nejaký úvod do Drupalu. A ešte určite budeme. Pokiaľ máte návrh na nejakú tému, tak dajte nám vedieť, radi privítame nejaké návrhy. Od zajtra spúšťame príjmanie návrhov na prednášky, čiže pokiaľ máte záujem prednášať, máte nejakú tému, ktorá si myslíte, že by zaujímala ostatných, tak neváhajte, prihláste od zajtra do približne konca prvého majového týždňa, potom zverejníme finálny program a na konci maja sa teda dúfam, že vidím aspoň so 100 ľuďmi v Bratislave.